Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all Dinarans on the go and in the know, wherever you may be, November 2, 2019. No hype, no BS, just the facts. Hit the like and subscribe buttons so you don't miss out on my next post. I encourage you, knowledge is power, stay informed and stay alert, and know that today, we are one day closer than yesterday. First article of interest. Fear factor is broken. Protesters demand removal of Iraqi government. Martin Chalov, Middle East correspondent, Friday, November 1, 2019, 14.40 DT. The biggest protest movement in Iraq since the fall of Saddam Hussein has pressed its demand for the removal of the elected government, staring down an embattled political elite and the widespread influence of Iran. Friday rallies of tens of thousands came a day after supporters of Iraq's embattled leader, Adil Abdul Mahdi, believed they had won the backing of one of two powerful figures that threatened his premiership, a development that appeared to stabilize his position on Thursday. But the dissenters who thronged central Baghdad on Friday suggested popular opinion, rather than backroom machinations, may determine the fate of the government. The size and momentum of protest has left officials wanting for responses and wrong-footed Tehran, which has not faced a threat to its authority of this scale in Iraq. Somehow the fear factor is broken, said Ayman Saab, a student protester speaking by phone from the Iraqi capital. You can see it in the people's eles here. Central Baghdad Tahrir Square was a chaotic scene of flag-waving demonstrators battling with security forces on Friday afternoon. Tuk-tuks ferried wounded dissenters under clouds of tear gas. Amnesty International this week accused Iraqi security chiefs of using military-grade tear gas up to 10 times more powerful than that typically used for crowd control to try to quell the unrest. At issue for many of the demonstrators is rampant corruption and the impunity of a ruling class that has siphoned off huge cuts from state revenues over much of the past 16 years. Other demonstrators, meanwhile, continue to rail at Iran, which has a whip hand in the affairs of Iraq and significant influence over its legislators. Since the U.S.-led invasion, political sectarianism has been entrenched by a system of governance that has demarcated power between majority Shias, Sunnis and Kurds in the country. Shia Iran has developed close links to many Iraqi MPs and broad networks within the central institutions. In addition, military groups loyal to Iran have taken prominent stakes in the affairs of state. Some factions, such as that led by populist cleric Muqtada al-Sadr, have established a political presence in the country parliament and can muster significant influence on lower-middle-class Shias, many of whom feel aggrieved by a lack of opportunities provided by successive governments. Al-Sadr had earlier threatened to withdraw his support for Abdul Mahdi's one-year-old administration, a move that would deal it a near-fatal blow if he mobilized loyalists at the same time. Another influential Shia cleric, Ayatollah al-Sistani, on Friday appeared to give support to the protests, warning of chaos and destruction if security forces continued a violent crackdown that has killed around 250 people since the rallies began, and wounded many hundreds more. Sistani has often been at odds with the conduct of Iraqi officials, and with Iran, whose influence his supporters say often diverges from the country interests. The prominent Iranian general Qasem Soleimani played a pivotal role during the week in stabilizing Abdul Mahdi. A source close to the Iraqi prime minister revealed he had warned the outspoken cleric to temper his criticism. Next article of interest. Soleimani warned Abdul Mahdi against attending a public session in parliament in return for protecting him from legal accountability. Saturday, November 2, 2019, 3 o'clock, Baghdad D. Hamid Abdullah. Prime Minister Adel Abdul Mahdi was in the House of Salah the moment he was asked by the House of Representatives to come to the Council to explain the government measures to calm the Iraqi street, and to answer questions from Iraqi MPs about the violence that affected protesters. Sources in the presidential square that includes the residence of Iraqi President Bahram Saleh said. She pointed out that Abdul Mahdi was afraid of parliamentary interrogation because of warnings received from the commander of the Iranian Quds force. Qasem Soleimani prevented him from disclosing corruption deals by political forces linked to Iran, as well as transfer large amounts of Iraq to Iran with the knowledge of Abdul Mahdi himself. The sources also said that Mahdi had intended to reveal the identities of the snipers who killed dozens of demonstrators in Tahrir Square, but he received a warning from Qasem Soleimani that his life would be in danger if he uncovered the scenes of Iranian plans to suppress the demonstrators. He called the head of the Human Rights Committee in the Iraqi parliament, Arshad al-Salehi, to attend the Commission on Human Rights to the House of Representatives to reveal the true numbers of martyrs and wounded of the uprising, provided that the Prime Minister is present to respond to the Commission information. Salehi said that the figures available to the Commission on Human Rights, according to the killing of 250 demonstrators and wounding 11,000 others, but he added that there is more serious information regarding the horrific killings carried out by security forces against demonstrators in Baghdad and a number of provinces, including the city of Karbala, which witnessed a horrific massacre. Despite the intensive contacts made by the Speaker of the Iraqi Parliament, Mohammed al-Albasi, Abdul Mahdi to attend a public questioning session, the latter refused to come to the parliament on the grounds that there are important developments in the political situation requires wait and wait. Soleimani reassured Abdul Mahdi that he would be free of judicial accountability if he agreed to a deal that would include a quiet constitutional dismissal without exposing the killings by secret chambers run by Soleimani in cooperation with Iranian-backed militia leaders. Next article of interest. Albasi, Parliament will be in permanent session to accelerate the implementation of the map set by the efforts 019/11/0201. 065 Baghdad. The Speaker of the Council of Representatives, Mohammed Albasi, on Sunday, the commitment to the map set by the religious authority, while announced the convening of Parliament permanently to speed up the implementation of this map. In these fateful days, the accelerating events in our dear country and the cries of reform flowing from the throats of the demonstrators in our provinces in the fields of brotherhood and altruism, Albasi said in a statement. Amen for Iraq, and the title of his unit, and the defender of the rights of all its components, the wise reference that is guided by the guidance of guidance in adversity and al-Mamat after the use of God Almighty. He added, so will your Council of Representatives, dear people in permanent session, continue tonight BNHARH. In order to accelerate the implementation of this map, which was organized and completed the march requirement of Free Iraq and the Master Blessed Sons, all in which the good and well-being, security and safety, we will work very hard on conducting all constitutional amendments in partnership with representatives of the demonstrators, elites, experts and respected academics living in the details of the Iraqi reality. He continued, we are working as a House of Representatives all intensively and continuously tonight for the people and their demands, without external pressure regionally or internationally, and without imposing personal or partisan wills. With his unity, his word and his own will. Next article of interest. Iraq government cannot reform itself. New Atlanticist by Samir Soumadevi. Baghdad, Iraq, November 1, 2019. In Washington, some believe that despite the protests in Iraq that began in early October and continue apace, the current Iraqi government should be supported and given help as it responds to the just demands of the protesters. The reasons given range from, what is the alternative? The devil you know is better than the devil you don't. To this is the constitutionally elected government, and challenging it risks chaos. That analysis might be convenient, but it is wrong. It does not take into account what has led to this explosion of public anger. The May 2018 elections were all but boycotted by the electorate. The turnout was claimed to be around 44%, but many believe it was much lower. That contrasts with a 60% turnout in recent previous elections even without all provinces fully participating. Then, in June 2018, a suspicious fire destroyed half of the ballots from the 2018 election, and the results were adjusted by an Electoral Commission EC, which should have been independent but was not. This is why one of the protester key demands is to rewrite the election law and reform the EC to make it independent. The constitutionality of the current political system is open to challenge in other important respects. The Constitution forbids discrimination on the basis of race, religion, and sect, but the current political order is predicated on the Prime Minister being Shia, the President Kurdish, and the Speaker of Parliament Sunni. I was part of the discussions which lead to the first application of the Muassasa system, which divides up the top posts and many others la Lebanon between various sects and ethnicities, and have been consistently against it. The late Jalal Talabani proposed it as a measure for just one electoral cycle to reassure everyone of being included and represented. What was introduced as a temporary measure turned into an imperative convention. The Constitution explicitly forbids militias. But there exist in Iraq heavily armed militias, and not just the popular mobilization forces, also known as the PMF with declared allegiance to Iran. Many of the PMF units were brought under the auspices of the state and fell in line with the legislation to formalize their continued existence. Other groups resisted that measure, including Asab al-Al-Haq, the Qatib Hezbollah, and Qatib al-Khorasani. Their leaders looked to Ayatollah Khomeini of Iran for political and spiritual guidance. These militias wield political as well as considerable military power. The militias may be behind much of the killing and maiming of unarmed protesters. President Barzani in his first statement about the violence mentioned elements who operate outside the constitution and laws of the country, stating they committed these crimes. The presence of these militias represents a parallel state which the government cannot control. Most importantly, the ruling clique has diverted the country revenue from oil, the country's primary source of income, into the pockets of the elite through an elaborate patronage scheme and corruption, resulting in the failure of the government to deliver essential services and widespread deprivation and desperation among the people. Young people would not go into the streets unarmed and aware that they face live bullets from the militias if they were not desperate. The Iraqi government, as it is constituted now and despite all past and present promises and claims to the contrary, does not have the political will or the capacity to deliver good governance. That is why the first demand of the protesters is for the government to step aside and be replaced, hopefully peacefully, by constitutional steps, by an emergency administration that is mandated to reform the system and start building a state that will function without corruption and foreign influence and deliver for its people. The Iraqi people and the young peaceful protesters deserve no less. The United States should be true to its values and stand with the protesters, as well as condemn the excessive violence directed at them and demand that it be stopped. The United States should support the protesters' demands to transform their system of government and make it less corrupt and more efficient, accountable, and representative, and therefore more stable. Moreover, all those changes would make the country more prosperous and free it from Iranian influence. These aims, if achieved, would clearly be in the national interest of the United States. Samir Soumadelli formerly served as Iraq ambassador to the United States and Iraq interior minister. More articles of interest to come. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button and the alert bell so you don't miss my next post. I encourage you, knowledge is power, stay informed and stay alert. Over and out for now, the Dinarian.